You're not turning this in. You will not be graded on this. I'm going to steal a page from Dr. McCoy's playbook because education is all about stealing. The best education educators out there take each other's ideas and share them, and they always credit each other.
No, I think, well, I'm not going to say that because it's live streaming. We're not live streaming, I'll tell you something else. But, so I'm going to go to my little place back here, and I'm going to type some of the things that you have written instead of what I would typically do is if I had a whiteboard or a chalkboard, you would just come up and write those things up here. But because of our space, I can't do that. So just start calling out some of the things slowly. I don't type quickly. That you put height. Thank you.
Skin color.
Face.
Pardon me?
Face.
Hold on a second. I just realized I can't spell. Okay. Next.
Demeanor.
What was that?
Demeanor.
Oh, please don't. Please. Okay, yes.
Ready.
Age.
Smile.
Smile.
Clothing.
Pardon me?
Clothing.
Clothing.
Hair.
Hair.
Weight.
Cool.
What?
Eye color.
Eye color. I couldn't hear something from over here. Sorry.
Posture.
Posture.
Language.
Language, if they're speaking, okay. Makeup. Gender. The surroundings that you were in when you see that person. Body language. Take hold. Eyes. We have eye color and then eyes. Take one more.
Tattoos.
Thank you. Did I spell that right? Or the two T's in the middle. Thank you. All right. Now, go back to what we were just doing. Go back to your line. What are the things that you don't see? Like all the things that you don't see when you first encounter someone. Under the line. Or what are the things about you that people don't see? Since it's hard to think about what you might not see about a different person, someone else. What are the things that you don't see in other people? In the interest of time, why don't you start telling me some of those things? And please keep in mind, if you're over here and I'm back here, it gets cut off. So wait till I pop my head out. Okay. So things below the line.
Inward or actual mood?
Is that the right mood? Mental illness. I missed something over here. Hold on. Insecurities, is that what you said? Okay. Boy, that's a really interesting way to spell religion. Yeah, okay.
Credos.
Pardon me?
Credos.
Credos.
Gender identity.
Gender identity.
Sexual orientation.
Actually, I type dyslexically.
Their goals.
Pardon me?
Goals.
Goals.
Work ethic.
Pardon? Okay, and I'll take one more. What was that last one?
Education.
Educational status. All right. So below the line, we have all those things that we don't typically, that we can't see. But all of these things together represent a much more broad view of, back to the slideshow here. Let me deal with the fact that I need reading glasses and I'm in total denial about that. All right, I have really bad eyesight. I have terrible eyesight. I have negative 10 to 10.5 contact lens prescription. That's how bad my eyes are. I thought there's no way I'm ever gonna need reading glasses because my eyes are already so bad. So I'm still in denial. All right, that's a little side story about me. Anyway, with this all, with that, what we wrote down on our sheets now, what I'm trying to get you to see and to recognize is culture. The line was a very simplistic way of representing much more beautifully depicted metaphors for culture. So the common metaphors that are being used now when we talk about culture are a tree and an iceberg. I tend to trend more towards the use of a tree than an iceberg, because an iceberg, well, global warming won't ruin my soccer. With the iceberg, it's the small thing that's at the top and then so much more below the surface. And I think that can be very true. What you physically see in someone is a small part of what they are, but really I think it isn't a small part of what they are necessarily. And the nice thing about a tree is that a tree continues to grow outwardly, visibly, as well as the root system continues to grow beneath the surface. So it's a little more equal between growth, what you can see and what you can't see. Culture involves both of those things. When we talk about culturally responsive teaching, sometimes we get into a narrow space where we view culturally responsive teaching as only being a benefit with regard to race, marginalized ethnicity, and language status. But when we go back to what we just wrote above and below those lines, we start to see culture as being much more broad. We start to see things like gender identity, sexual identity, religion, political beliefs, status within a profession. All of those things create cultural groups. You, as music students, live in multiple cultures. I live in multiple cultures. I am a university professor, so I live within the culture of the academy. I am a music teacher who taught elementary general music for a very long time. So I still go back and forth within that specific culture. I am the mother of two teenagers. I like to think of that as another circle in Dante's Inferno at times. love my children, they're wonderful and awesome. They're watching. They're not.
I hope that they're still.
These are cultures. I am white. Yeah, I am. Dr. McCoy in a very funny way said that she was black and she was and still is. I'm white
and I still am.
That's not going to change. Does that mean I don't have a culture? I do have a culture. A very specific culture. And I have a culture that impacts how I learn and how I think. Just like your multiple cultures impact how you learn and how you think. I love this quote. I use this quote all the time. And it's so fun when you quote someone and they're in the audience. So if we think about the perspective of other cultures, our perspective of other cultures often focuses on the artifacts that are the results of cultural processes. When we consider those aspects of our own culture, we would wish others to understand. They often include those deeper, less visible, but perhaps more significant aspects of culture, such as our values and our beliefs.
We always have to be careful that we're not boiling culture down to simplistic things like food and costume. Because when we do that, we're minimizing what culture really is for people. It's very important. Your values and your beliefs shape who you are personally, and they're also influenced by your culture. So today, in Thinking Culturally, which was the broad title for this session, what I want to do is I'd like to examine with you what is the culture of American music education. I'd also like to look at and take an historical perspective to consider the impact of the judicial system and the educational system on the creation of a cultural norm within education. Now, we don't have a lot of time, so we're going to kind of whip on through this, but this will give you some motivation, hopefully, to look into these things a little more deeply on your own. I want to look specifically at achievement as a goal and as an excuse and how that relates to culturally responsive teaching, actually the myth of achievement. And then also I want to present somewhat of a framework for understanding a culturally responsive mindset. So it's pretty ambitious, but let's buckle our seatbelts and go. The most powerful evidence of teaching effectiveness is, by far, the personal story. You've already heard my story in a couple, if you were at the keynote, you heard a lot about my story. Don't think you've heard me otherwise, so something down. So I'm going to share another story that touches on culture and on teaching effectiveness that comes from my teaching history. A couple of months ago, probably about 6 or 8 months ago, I updated something on Facebook, and I must have downloaded Messenger. I don't know what I did, but all of a sudden I noticed that I had a bunch of messages in my independent Messenger app that I had not seen before. So I went back through them, and one of them was a name that was familiar, vaguely familiar. And the young woman's last name was the same last name as one of my son's best friends. But I knew that she wasn't part of that group. So I opened it up out of curiosity, and I begin reading it, and it starts, "I hope this is Miss Kelly," which was my name when I taught elementary school before I was married. "I hope this is Miss Kelly. If it is, I am fill in the blank. I've been looking for you." And she went on to talk about, "I'd really like to connect with you on Facebook, blah, blah, blah." So I shoot a message back, and I remember you. As she detailed some things in the message, her face came back, and I started remembering her. Now, I taught in elementary school with a lot of students. I had years where I had 800 students in the building. But I remembered this student. So I sent her an email and I said, "Of course I remember you. I'm so happy to reconnect with you. Please tell me what you're doing." So she comes back with, "Oh, I'm a kindergarten bilingual teacher. I am so excited. I love teaching. I think about you all the time. My favorite memory of elementary general music class that I carry with me everywhere was when you would let myself and then two of her other friends spend recess in the music room, and we would perform our Britney Spears routines for you." Okay, now, I'm a recovered Kodai teacher, so I was very happy to see this now, because I realized that it wasn't necessarily what I was doing in the music classroom, it was the community I was creating, and it was this sense of acceptance that I obviously put out there to my students, where they felt comfortable coming in and not only practicing their routines, but wanting to perform them for me and asking me to help them and to work with them. And so now this former student of mine and myself we're now connected on Facebook, and I see the wonderful things that she does in her kindergarten classroom and the way that she incorporates music in her kindergarten classroom. And then the whole DACA issue arose. And I had posted something, because I know that a lot of my former students will be impacted by this. But I didn't think she would. And I posted something about it, and she responded, and she outed herself as a dreamer. And here she is, a public school kindergarten teacher, who because of DACA is able to teach, and she has that fear of what is going to happen. So there's another aspect of culture that is impacting her classroom, for her as a teacher, is impacting what she's doing in her classroom. But my impact for understanding and thinking deeply about culture has an impact too. So those personal stories really play a lot into what we want to think about and talk about. So I'm going to ask you to do a little activity with the people around you. So just kind of turn groups of 3 to 5, whatever. I'm going to limit your time on this, so this is going to be like a drive-by. Describe your background in music education to whoever's around you. Go, quickly. 2 or 3 people, so we can make this quick. Member raised their hand and said, look, we all just need to understand that there are certain pieces of music that teach certain skills that I must use in my studio And that's why our repertoire lists look so similar. And another faculty member stood up and said, "You mean to tell me there's nothing written by a person of color or by a woman that could teach the same exact skills that something that's written by a dead white guy could teach?" And you could feel the tension rise. Some of us were like, "Go, go, go." And other people were like, "Oh my gosh, I didn't have enough coffee today." And it was, and the person facilitating the session, it was kind of caught in the crosshairs and defaulted to the, "Well, you know what, we're running out of time, so we need to move on." And the conversation stopped. And it's a shame, because it's a conversation we need to have. It's a conversation that says a lot about, in the previous session when I'm talking about identity, I talk about the simple fact that the world is not your mirror. As much as we want to think that the rest of the world looks and acts and reacts and listens and participates exactly the way we do, it doesn't. But we sometimes perpetuate this myth in our isolated culture of the School of Music, or in PK-12 music teaching, that it does. European and middle class beliefs are the driving forces in education, seen as the normal and right thing to do in schools. So now I need my reading glasses again because the print's too small on my sheet here. Boykin says this. This is true. The way we teach, not just in music, the way we teach in every subject in our public school system is predicated on normative values that are set forth by the dominant culture. I just said a whole lot of words there. Normative values are set forth by the dominant culture. It's the privilege of the dominant culture to determine what you learn. I took my children, we go to Panama a lot as a family. My stepmother's Panamanian, so we travel to Panama. And we've done the Panama Canal a lot. But last year, for the first time, we did the Panama Canal Museum. We went to the museum, and it was eye-opening. Because the museum is unapologetic about some of the awful things that the United States did to the Panamanian citizens. We tend to think of our involvement in the Panama Canal as being very, very positive. But the Panamanians don't view it that way. I had never thought of it that way. When my kids walked out of the museum, my son turned to me and said, "Wow, that's the first time I ever heard anybody talk about Americans as not being positive." And I said, "Well, do you think that means it's not true?" And he goes, "No, I think it's really true. It's really sad." But our educational system oftentimes sets up things in a way that we don't look at something other than through a very specific lens. A single story, and I talked about that in the previous session also. It's a single story. We don't look at what other aspects, other viewpoints. When we think about Native Americans, when we think about Japanese Americans who were interred after the bombing of Pearl Harbor. We created camps in this country. We don't always talk about that because our textbooks are created through a single vantage point. A lot of our textbooks, not necessarily music, but a lot of our textbooks outside of music, the content of the textbook is actually determined by, does anyone know who determines content in most textbooks? Texas. The Texas Board of Education has more power than anybody else when it comes to textbooks. That's a very narrow and limited view. So, there's a historical basis for a lot of what we're talking about here. The first is the Supreme Court case, Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896. Anyone know what this case?
Is that the streetcar?
Separate but equal. This was the court case that determined that it was okay to segregate students based on race as long as you were providing equal educational opportunities. Equal is a very tricky word. It is open to interpretation. So this is when we had the black school and the white school. With our changing demographics, if Plessy versus Ferguson still stood, we'd have a black school, we'd have a white school, we'd have a white upper class school, we'd have a white lower class school. We would have a second language school for people who speak Spanish. We'd have a school for people who speak Arabic. We would have a, see where that's coming, all right? Separate but equal. Then in 1954, a long time later, Brown versus the Board of Education happened that turned over Plessy versus Ferguson, that said separate but equal was not enough. And that led to a lot of issues with desegregation. Now, not a court case, but something that has been going on in education and for about 5 or 6 years ago was still really a rage in terms of, I remember being at, was at an ORF conference, and there were two sessions using Ruby Payne's framework for understanding poverty as a way to teach. Oh, I know. I was like, oh. I should probably explain who that is before I show you how upset I was about it. But Ruby Payne got her doctorate at Loyola University in Chicago, I'm embarrassed to say, which is down the street from my institution. And she now makes a lot of money going around doing seminars for school administrators and teachers who have low-income populations in their schools. Basically, what she says is that kids who live in poverty because they're in a culture of poverty, and that the only way they can get out of that culture of poverty is if they're taught to act like the dominant cultural majority. So let's teach impoverished kids to act like white middle-class kids. It's the deficit perspective on steroids is what it is. And it's something that it's now waning a lot of education. My thing is broken. I had to holding this on the back. I was waiting for that to happen. But it's one of those things that has been perpetuated. And now, fortunately, due to some educational researchers who've gotten very loud about it, it's being torn, it's being deconstructed, and people are walking back from it somewhat. So the last thing I have on there is an NPR story. There was a fascinating NPR story about desegregation in St. Louis that is recent. Now, when I was in school, when I was in elementary school, desegregation was going on in the Pittsburgh public schools. Lots of kids were being bused, and there were lots of people were very upset about it. But desegregation kind of fell aside, and it was just sort of assumed that people would keep that up. So if you look at Chicago today, you see probably the most segregated city in the country. I lived in a city neighborhood called Canaryville for a while. Canaryville was bounded by the train tracks on the east, Halsted Street on the west, 39th Street on the south, and 49th Street on the north, 49th Street on the south. Very small area. White, Irish, Catholic immigrants founded the neighborhood. I did an ethnographic study, and what I found was when I looked at the church registry, 75% of the current parishioners were related to the founding parishioners. Probably one of the only neighborhoods that's still that, and it's an enclave. You can't buy a house in that neighborhood. Well, you can, it's a little better now, but you couldn't buy a house in that neighborhood unless you're related to somebody. Okay. Just south of 49th Street is a neighborhood that you might recognize the name, Englewood. It's known as one of the more violent neighborhoods in Chicago. Austin is the other one. Literally right there. Okay. The city of Chicago They have only one select enrollment high school north of Roosevelt Avenue. So the north side, which is the wealthiest side of the city, has all the select enrollment high schools. So even though segregation is not supposed to be an issue, it is. This NPR story talked about St. Louis and talked about a young woman's struggle in 2 to 3 hours a day on buses to go to a high school and how in this day and age, she was discriminated against because of her race. That people were at school board meetings yelling that they did not want this group of kids to come to their high school. So that still happens. So this is how culture impacts teaching. So achievement or lack thereof is an experience or an accomplishment. It is not the totality of the student's personal identity or the essence of his or her human work. Yet we tend to fall back on achievement as an excuse. We want students to achieve, so now we've boiled students down to a test score. Okay? We say that achievement is the test score. And achievement is the metric by which we determine whether or not someone is doing well. So what is achievement? So achievement is this idea that every student can do well. Now we're getting into a colorblind perspective as well, that everybody can do well. Everybody can do well. Okay, everybody can do well, but everybody can't do well if we teach everybody as if they are exactly the same person. I've known teachers who create their lesson plans for the entire school year in the summer. So they have an entire year of lesson plans created and numbered, lesson one, lesson two, lesson three, lesson four, and they do not deviate from those lessons. I think that's kind of on the borderline of irresponsible, but it is irresponsible. That's irresponsible. If you're following a prescriptive lesson plan, even if you created it, you're not reacting to the student sitting in front of you. You have absolutely no way of knowing you're connecting with the student because you're teaching what's on the page. You're not teaching the student in front of you. So when someone says, in order for students to achieve, we need to do this without taking into consideration difference, it's a recipe for failure. I know Gloria Ladson-Billings has this wonderful article titled, It's Just Good Teaching, and what she says in the article is very, very true, but I just want to pull that title out a little bit and say, It's Just Good Teaching, again, puts teaching on the teacher and not on the students. Teaching has to be shared. As a teacher, you have a lot of power. You make a lot of decisions. But when you're a good teacher, you're negotiating your decisions. You're looking at the students in front of you. You're working together. Your students aren't working for you. I think that's an attitude that a lot of people have. My students are going to do really well because they listen to me. I think my students will do really well because they talk to me. And because I listen to them. The other thing is when we're measuring good teaching, whose metric are we using to measure good teaching? Standardized tests are really difficult as a measure of achievement, but we use them. In fact, there's a lot of literature out there that asks the question about how standardized tests can be culturally biased. There's also cultural bias in what we do in our classroom. And we need to keep those things in mind. We can't just assume. Here's just a quick story before I get to the slide. Here's just a quick story, that an example of something that I experienced teaching at kindergarten, first grade music class. I was singing a song, and it was just an obscure song. I didn't think about anything in the song other than what we were doing with it, fast and slow. Did you train on so fast, can't see nothing but the window glass. Paige's mule runs so slow, there'll always be another road to hoe. To which a young boy jumped up, pointed at me, and yelled, You can't say that in school! I can't say what? It's not nice to call a girl that! Has anyone got it yet? Yeah. The child had no conception of what a garden hoe was. Why should we? It was an urban environment. Well, it was a suburban environment, but it might as well have been an urban environment. Not many people have backyard gardens anymore. It's in that area. Why would this child know? He thought I was calling Paige a hoe. Oh, that rhyme. How fun was that? He had no idea. Now think about sitting down and taking a standardized test and coming across something like that. Coming across a reading passage with a term that you've never heard before, and you're already under the pressure of the standardized test. Your brain is going to freak out a little bit because it's already freaking out because of the pressure of the test. And instead of getting back and focusing on what you're doing, you're trying to figure out what this passage is talking about because you know you can't answer the questions, even though you probably can, or maybe you can, but the mismatch there puts you at a distinct disadvantage. It puts other people at a disadvantage. Third is that the one mindset positive results in your educational and political action program, which fails to respect the particular view of the world held by the people. Such a program I love the addition of good intentions notwithstanding. Because you know what? A lot of times we make mistakes as teachers, and we well, Lord knows that one. Made them with good intentions. But it's important to be able to step back and start thinking about what it is that we're doing. Are we perpetuating a cultural norm because it's what we were taught? And it's the excuse of, but it was the way I was taught good enough. Do you know why parents struggle so much with curricular change in schools? Because the implication is that the way they were taught was not good enough. Instead of recognizing that the world has changed and there are different ways of learning, and we know more about how we learn. School districts that do a good job of implementing curricular change are school districts that communicate with parents in a way that tells parents that the way they were taught worked for the way they were then, and emphasizes the fact that education cannot be static. Okay, so when we look at culture responsive teaching, I should look at my talk. How am I doing? Okay, when we look at culture responsive teaching, this is what's important to understand. Culture counts. I think I've been getting that one home pretty hard to you right now. Yes? Cultural reform is inadequate. We've got conventional, not cultural. Conventional reform is inadequate because conventional reform tends to try to replicate the dominant viewpoint. Intention without action is insufficient. Thinking that this is a good thing, agreeing that this is a good thing, is just that. It's not sufficient. Acting on it is. And guess what? It's also hard. But it's the point. Strength and vitality of cultural diversity. Understanding that there is so much positivity to come out of recognizing cultural diversity. Look at your lines again. Look at the things that were below the lines. Look at the things above the lines. Look at how rich a person is when they have all of those things above and below the lines. Test scores and grades are symptoms, not causes of achievement problems. This is the biggest issue with achievement when we're talking about achievement, is we think that the test score tells us that the students are not achieving, but no. What the test score is telling us is that there's something going on with how we are teaching and what we are teaching. Let's start using test scores as a measure of how and what we teach as opposed to whether or not a child is smart enough or good enough. So how do we define culture? I like this explanation. The dynamic system of social values, cognitive, cultural, behavioral standards, worldviews, and beliefs used to give order and meaning to our own lives as well as the lives of others. I also like to think of culture as that shared system of beliefs between various groups based on experiences and identity. Culture determines how we think, believe, and behave. We all come from different homes, we all come from different backgrounds, we were all raised in different ways. There are people who tell me to say, well, just tell me, what do I need to know about my students who are from Mexico? Tell me, what do I need to know about my students who are from the Ukraine? What do I need to know about my students? Yes, there are some broad paint strokes there that we can talk about, but it's always important to remember that those aren't absolutes either. You know, one of the common things that I was told when I first started teaching in a predominantly Hispanic school was that, so if I was being disciplined by a teacher, I would look at the teacher behind him. I don't know how comfortable that was because I was taught that that was a sign of respect. But within Hispanic cultures, with Mexican culture primarily, eye contact is viewed as being defiant. And so when you're working with a student and the student is, you're having a serious discussion, and the student is looking at the floor, sometimes teachers would say, no, you need to look at me. Yeah, that can be difficult, that can be challenging for the child, okay? But also, I have to say, be careful, don't fall into this idea that that's an absolute thing, because it does vary. And it's getting to know the students in front of you. To has this figure in her specific book that looks at the mitigating variables of culture. So affiliation, gender, age, social class, education, individuality, residence, immigration, as some of the mitigating variables. And these arrows here, the blue arrows, mean that they influence each other. This is not hierarchical, okay? It's just an influence across this list. Then you look at this list, expressive behaviors, thinking, relating, speaking, writing, performing, producing, learning, and teaching. I like to look at this right after I said what I just said in terms of eye contact. Because this says it much better. But this is saying that these mitigating variables combined with ethnicity and culture and these expressive behaviors are all interrelated. So a person's gender, age, and immigration status might impact how they perform or how they think or how they speak, as well as their ethnicity and culture impact that. So it's an interrelated dynamic system. If you've read Dr. McCoy and Dr. Lin's book, they have a beautiful figure that really looks at culturally responsive teaching and music and how this functions, and I encourage you to look at that as well. So, as I have been saying, teachers and students come into the classroom with their own culturally based assumptions and beliefs. And this can create dichotomous relationships. I love that word. Conflict or accommodation. Rejection and acceptance. Alienation and withdrawal. So all of these things can happen within a classroom depending upon not just the teacher's attitude, but also the student's attitude. It's a two-way street again. It's not just the teacher. It's a two-way street. So we frame our accounts of our cultural origins and our most cherished beliefs in story form. And it's not just the content of these stories they grip us, but their narrative artifice. Our immediate experience, what happened yesterday and the day before, is framed in the same story way. Even more striking, we represent our lives to ourselves as well as to others in the form of narrative. So, a couple minutes, so I just want to run through this with you super quickly. I want you to, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do the other thing I was going to do. I did this with the earlier session today accidentally because I really only meant to do it with your section. But I'm glad I did it with the earlier section, so now I'm going to do it with your section. In light of this idea of narrative and the stories that I have shared with you thus far, I want to share with you a story from Lydia Cortez in the form of a poem. Lydia Cortez's sister is Sonia Nieto, who is a bilingual bicultural educator. Talks a lot about bilingual, talks a lot about bilingual education. And this is a poem she wrote about her experiences in school. I remember kindergarten. I remember having to say goodbye to mommy. I remember crying. I remember not understanding the teacher. I remember the English lessons with pretty Miss Powell, who made the boxy words fit just right in my mouth without pain. I remember the teachers who said, "You don't look Puerto Rican," expecting to hear me say, "Thank you very much." I remember overhearing some saying, "Puerto Ricans don't care about their children. Puerto Ricans aren't clean." I remember the heat of shame rising up, changing the color of my face. I remember praying no one heard what the teacher said, praying no one see my hurt, red as a broken heart. I remember Mr. Seideman in the fourth grade and how he chose me for a big part in the school play. I remember feeling important. I remember memorizing all those lines and mommy helping me. I remember both Mr. Seideman and mommy smiling, proud, looking at me the night of the performance. I remember making the audience laugh and the applause. I remember moving from Flatbush, from Fort Greene, from a fifth floor walk-up to our very own house. I remember going from Girls High to Erasmus Hall. I remember going from smart to borderline in one day. I remember the bio teacher, Miss Nash, calling me stupid because I didn't know how to use a microscope. I remember Mr. and Mrs. Hamburger. I remember how I laughed when I heard I was getting one for political science and the other for economics. I remember being amazed when they made learning a wonder-filled adventure. I remember working hard for both of them and the faith each had in me. I remember the A's I got in their classes. I remember being Puerto Rican in Erasmus Hall High School because I was the only one until my sister followed on the academic track. I remember the guidance counselor advising me to be a bilingual secretary because I certainly was not college material. I remember Poppy with his third grade education saying, Lyndon, tú puedes hacer lo que quieres, yo te apoyo el todo siempre. You can do what you want. I support you always. I think that this poem does such a beautiful job of encapsulating the power that teachers have when they do and when they don't recognize culture. Yes, we have power, but our power must always be measured with empathy and understanding and respect.